alcohol inks are an incredibly versatile product. From simple drops you can doodle on to fine art painting, these inks can do it all. In today's video, I'll demo some techniques you can use to create beautiful abstract art with metallic accents. I'll be using inks from Ranger and Jacquard and will be working on Yupo. As this video debuts on May 8th, 2019, we'll be offering Ranger alcohol inks and Yupo pads on sale at 25% off. Before I begin, a big shout out to several artists whose videos I watched to get the hang of this abstract process of combining alcohol inks, whether they're plain or metallic, and alcohol. So thanks to Marissa of Actuary Art, Miriam of Miriam's Nature, and Gabrielle Polacco. Their techniques fed into my work, allowing me a head start as I figured out how to play with the inks to get results that I liked. The first piece of advice I want to give you about this is to know your colors. One of my earliest alcohol ink videos talked about creating a color chart that's just a single drop of a color, allowing it to bloom and seeing what it looks like. You don't necessarily have to do that for this process, but testing colors is going to allow you to see that some are going to bloom with a different aura, and that'll help you know what to expect. So I have sailboat blue, lettuce, and eggplant, and all of them are going to bloom with a different color aura. Now, alcohol ink is a beast that pretty much does what it wants to. So some of the time you're going to bloom and you're going to get nice round circles. Others of the time you're going to get these funky feathery edges. You never know. You can manipulate and push alcohol ink around to a certain extent to get it to do what you want, but there are going to be times when it decides that it's going to do exactly what it wants. So let's just see if I can get a bigger drop going here. You can see that the stonewashed has got a really pretty pink aura. Lettuce is going to bloom with a yellow aura. Whoops, and as I knock things over. And the eggplant has decided it's simply not going to bloom into a round dot at all. But you can just see here the pink that begins to form in those feathery little edges. So it's important to know these things as you're working so that you know what to expect when you add alcohol. So that is the other part of this. This is 91% isopropyl alcohol that I have in one of our fine line bottles. This is one with the ones that are either a 24 or 25 gauge tip will work. And the way that you're going to do this is you're going to push alcohol into the alcohol inks. We're going to manipulate it with some air, and we're going to add some metallics to get some really interesting looks. So where did my pieces go? So these little pieces, again, I'm working on right now, these are our Yupo ATCs. For this kind of play, I don't want to use big pieces of Yupo. It gets too expensive. You're not going to love everything you do to begin with. I promise that you're not, because you have to kind of get the hang of this and work with it a little bit. So I worked on ATC size pieces of Yupo, and I didn't feel so bad when I had to use both sides, like neither of them, and toss it. So with those basics covered, let me clean up what I've got going on here, and I'll come back and I'm going to show you the basics. I'll start with just taking a color and feeding some alcohol into it, and then we'll go for the gusto and we'll work with a color and the metallics and some alcohol. The basic premise of this entire process is using alcohol to thin the color and combine it with an air source to push it all around. Now, I've seen people use a straw, some people use canned air, some people use a hairdryer. None of those worked particularly well for me. I tried a bulb syringe, and this actually worked pretty well. I like a little bit of air that I can control, and so this worked for a while, but then I felt that I needed to do something that didn't require me to constantly squeeze the thing. So my solution was, and if you have somebody in your family who uses one of these, this is a hose from a CPAP machine. On the floor next to my workbench is the actual CPAP machine, and what I did was take, so I had a package from CVS that had two of these bulb syringes in it. One of them had this removable tip on it. So I took the tip off, and all I've done is masking taped it in place. I did have to monkey with the settings on the CPAP to really reduce the air pressure to as low as it would go. Some people like a lot of air movement. I actually like it much less. I feel like I'm a little bit more in control that way. So again, an ATC-sized piece of Yupo. One of the hardest things with this, for me at least, is to remember that there are times that the best thing that you can do is nothing, is to just leave the stuff alone and let it do its own thing. So I'm going to put some alcohol ink down, that's stream. I'm going to put some alcohol down, and I'm going to start moving it around. Now, gravity will move some of this for you too, so don't lose sight of that as an option to help you move things around. But in comes my air source, and you can see that I'm starting to move the color around. So two things are happening here. I am moving the color around, and because alcohol ink is a solvent base, it does not dry in the way that, for example, a dilution spray ink on a piece of paper would dry. This has to evaporate off. You have a piece of plastic with a solvent base, so that evaporation is what causes the product to dry. So my air source is going to move the product around, but it's also going to dry it. So this is kind of interesting. I have some cool patterns going on there. If I decide that I want to soften this edge a little bit, I want it a little bit more wispy looking, I want it to kind of fade out, I can put some ink on there and come in and start to drive the color around. Remembering that sometimes the best thing that you can do is nothing. Sometimes the best thing I can do is walk away and leave this alone, or at least leave it alone for a moment to allow some of the evaporation to happen, and then I can come back and start using my source, my air source, to either dry or to manipulate things around. Now I kind of like the way that looks. It's a little bit ethereal looking. So here's the other thing I don't want you to lose sight of. There are no art police. If you have something that you really don't like, and you'll maybe see me do this as we go along, if I think that I have a mistake here, all I have to do is come in with a little bit of alcohol on a Q-tip and I might be able to remedy that mistake. Now it depends. Some alcohol inks, when you put them on Yupo, stain almost immediately and there's a limit to how much you can fix. But I don't want you to feel like there's somebody who's going to say, oh no, you can't do that. Well, that's a bunch of nonsense. You can do whatever you want. I'm not going to tell you you can't, and nobody else should either. You should play with this. The goal here is to enjoy what you're creating. And if that means coming in with a Q-tip and taking out something that you don't like, then by all means, let's do that. So you can see, again, I've got some really cool patterning going on over here. I'm going to use my air source to kind of thin this out and push this away. If I don't like that little finger thing that sticks out there, well, I'm going to at least lighten it to the point where it's not quite as obvious. So this is one of many ways that you can work with this. The next thing that you can do, and let's be brave here, let's bring in another one of the ATCs. I'm going to just kind of lean against my hose here so it doesn't disappear. I'm going to bring in, this is a very dirty bottle of actually Jacquard's shell pink color. Unfortunately, it got spilled all over with something else and it's an utter mess, but what's inside works just fine. This is Jacquard's brass color in their metallics. I'm going to shake it so that I get all the pigment that's in there up and moving around. The process when you use the metallic is the same, except for the fact that now you're going to get all the drama that goes with the metallic. So I'm going to put a drop of this down. I'm going to come and put a drop of the brass in it, or two drops. And now what I have found is if I come into the top and I put alcohol in the top here, it breaks this up into a million little pieces. But if I come in along the side like this, it actually causes the alcohol, excuse me, it causes the metallic pigment in there to almost pool together like that, so I get these blocky pieces. Now again, remembering that sometimes the best thing that I can do is nothing, it's really tempting for me to continue to manipulate this. So what I'm going to do is just pick up a little bit of the alcohol and get rid of some of it, and yeah, I'm going to pick up some of the metallic too. But now I can come back with my air source and I can start moving things around. Now it is, I don't know what that is, but that's just something that we're going to ignore for the sake of what we're doing. I'm demoing here, not making great art, but you can see with my air source I can start to maneuver things around. I can cause the metallic to move one way or the other. I can create thin areas if I want, or I can come back with this and I can create these kind of edges that have all that metallic color on it. I know the glare is a nightmare, it's a little hard to see, so I'm going to turn this like this and some of the color is going to pool at the bottom, but you can see that I can still come back and move this and kind of get this up here and doing what I want. Let's grab a piece of paper towel. So if I bring this in and just kind of work on this paper towel, I can drive some of this color off. And again, this is not great art. This is me trying to show you some ways that you can use that. And I don't like the way that that looks at all. So let's bring in another one and start again, because this is the way it goes sometimes. As you get comfortable with the process, you'll do better. And for me, it's a little bit more difficult because I'm trying to hold it so you can see it while at the same time manipulate it in a way that doesn't make an utter mess. So again, much less alcohol this time, and all I'm doing is allowing the air to push the color and the metallic around so I get this kind of rim of metal that happens around it. Now again, it's moving because it's still wet. But if I just play with this a little bit, and I'm going to kind of turn this. So now I have this pattern that's formed up here that I actually think is pretty cool. So when you do this and you start to get comfortable with the process of creating this kind of wispy, ethereal, fairy-like look, then the next step, and let's just slide that out of the way, the next step is to work on a larger piece of Yupo. Let's get brave here for a second. And to bring in a couple of colors and work like this. Now, when I do this, I like to leave a lot of white space. I'm going to hold this up so that you can see it. I'm not convinced that this is done, but I like what I have so far. I might want to make this a little bit bigger, or the other option would be to cut it down so there's not so much white space and it looks like this is lost in the center. And then this I really like a lot. This is something that, as long as I don't ruin it with my dirty hands, I might actually consider putting in a frame. So that's what we're going to do next. This is 5x7 Yupo, so I'm going to come back and we'll play with two different colors and with the metallics till we get something that's this kind of abstract painting that goes on in the center with all this lovely soft edges that go on here. When I create these small paintings, even on a 5x7 piece like this, I begin in the center, I concentrate in the color and the metallic there, and then let it get wispy as it comes out to the edges. So that's pretty much what I'm going to do here, and I'm not going to promise to make you great art because it's hard, as I said, for me to do and show you at the same time. But the thing that I want to remind you of is to be kind to yourself and give yourself some time to learn the process. I'm still getting the hang of it. Some pieces I like better than others. Some of them land right in the trash, but I think with each one I learn a little bit more. Even if I don't necessarily like or want to save the piece, I've learned something when I do it. So I have lettuce and stream, and I have the pinata brass, and of course I have my alcohol in the bottle. So I'm going to start with lettuce because that's the first one that I picked up. I'm going to kind of work on a diagonal. So to do that, I'm going to start with a drop of lettuce. And for me, even though this is a larger piece, I want to work small. If I want to add multiple sections of green, I can do that without feeling like I need to fill this whole piece at once. So I'm going to go with less alcohol here. I'm going to let gravity help me a little bit as I move this around. And I have Q-tips at the ready. If I feel like I have something I don't like, I'm going to change it with a Q-tip. So I've got some movement going on here. And now I'm going to bring in my air source, and I'm just going to slowly start moving this around. The key very often is to kind of go back and forth. You can let the colors spread a little bit, but to get that interesting patterning that goes on in the middle, the way to make that happen is to keep pushing the ink back and forth over one area. And at the same time, I'm getting this really cool ridge of color, of metallic that's happening around the edges. So I actually like this, and again, remembering one of the hardest things to do is nothing, I'm going to bring in a little bit of alcohol. I just want to see if I can soften this edge a little bit. Now, every time I put alcohol on, you can see it pushes into the color. It's going to make a hard line. That's what it does. So I'm going to do that, and I'm going to allow that to happen. And unfortunately, I talked too much before I started to actually do anything. So I'm going to do that again, but I'm going to allow this to come in, and you can see I'm getting that wispy yellowy green that's happening down there. I'm going to push some more of the color down there. And if I feel as though I want to come in with some more of the metallic, I can do that. But before I go that far, I'm going to leave this alone. And now I'm going to come with the stream kind of over here on the other side. I like where this is going, but I want to see what happens when I put this deep turquoise in. So again, one small drop. Just give this a little bit of a shake with some of the metallic. And then I'm going to come in with the alcohol. Again, I'm going to pick it up and I'm going to start moving the color around. So now I've got the turquoise, the stream overlapping with the green. I actually like that. And you know what? I'm going to give this a second to just settle itself a little bit. I like the way that this is filling in right here. I like this soft fade that's going on there. So I'm going to hold my, you can't see it, but I've got my air supply up here at the top. I want to evaporate some of this color off. I don't really care where it's going right now. This I'm really liking, and I like this thing that's happening here. So as I get rid of some of the alcohol, I can come in and I can start pushing this around. Actually, I waited just long enough, so I've got that nice soft thing happening there. But I think what I want to do is add a little bit more of the stream here. with a little bit more of the metallic and come in with the alcohol. And this time I'm going to work rather than talk because I kind of want to get some more of a fade going here. Just want to break that glob up the tiniest little bit, and now I want to see if I can push it this way a little bit, just a little tiny bit, and again leaving it alone because sometimes the best thing is to just leave it alone. I really like the way that that looks, so maybe now I'm going to extend the green this way a little bit. So a tiny little drop. Well, let's sometimes the lettuce, well, not the lettuce, sometimes these will want to come out really fast. So I'm going to hit this with a paper towel, which hopefully will allow me to get a fairly small blob, some more of the brass, some more of the alcohol, and let's see what I can do here. I think I'm going to come up with my air source up at the top and just let some evaporation happen. I'm going to allow the color to move a little bit, but from a long distance. Once this settles down a little bit, I'll be able to come back and push it around. But there's still a fair amount of liquid on there. So this is, for me, I am not the most patient person in the world, and the people who know me well will not discover that as any kind of a surprise. For me, the hardest thing is waiting, but I really like the way that this looks, so I'm not going to touch this. I am just going to allow a little bit more of evaporation to happen here. And so this is the process. Regardless of how big the piece of paper is or how small, I'm going to work pretty small. I find that I get better results when I don't try to cover a large area all at once. Now, you may discover that you work entirely different. My goal is not to have you work like me. My goal is to help you understand the technique so that you can create things that you enjoy. You like the end product, and you like the process of doing it. So there you go. I mean, these are pretty simple techniques using really simple tools and really simple products. Once you get through with these, now again, I like this. I might fill this out a little bit, or I might trim it down so that I don't have so much white space and go ahead and stick it under a frame. But you can do anything you want with this, whether you frame it as a little painting, you can use it as a card front, cut it up into shapes, add layers to your journals and your mixed media projects. There's all kinds of ways to use these pieces.